Good morning and welcome to Good Shepherd Anglican Church. Whether you are joining us live on Sunday morning or if you are watching this recording later, we're very happy that you're here. Let us now prepare our hearts and minds to worship God as we come before Him on this second Sunday after Pentecost. The kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe in the gospel.
O come, let us worship.
Dear friends in Christ, as we prepare to worship Almighty God, let us with penitent and obedient hearts confess our sins, that we may obtain forgiveness by His infinite goodness and mercy.
Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against You in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved You with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of Your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in Your will and walk in Your ways, to the glory of Your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy upon you. Pardon and deliver you from all your sins. Confirm and strengthen you in all goodness and keep you in eternal life. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Lord, open our lips.
And our mouths shall proclaim your praise.
O God, make speed to save us.
O Lord, make haste to help us. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
Please join in singing the invitatory hymn, The Spirit of the Lord. Join in saying a portion of Psalm 116 responsively by whole verse. I love the Lord because he has heard the voice of my supplication, because he has inclined his ear to me whenever I called upon him.
How shall I repay the Lord for all the good things he has done for me?
I will lift up the cup of salvation and call upon the name of the Lord.
I will fulfill my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people.
Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his servants.
O Lord, I am your servant. I am your servant and the child of your handmaid. You have freed me from my bonds.
I will offer you the sacrifice of thanksgiving and call upon the name of the Lord.
I will fulfill my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people.
In the courts of the Lord's house, in the midst of you, O Jerusalem.
Hallelujah. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
Reading from the book of Exodus. These are the names of the sons of Israel who came to Egypt: Simeon, Levi, and Judah, Issachar, Zebulun, and Benjamin, Dan and Naphtali, Gad and Asher. The total number of people born to Jacob was 70. Joseph was already in Egypt. Then Joseph died, and all his brothers and that whole generation. But the Israelites were fruitful and prolific. They multiplied and grew exceedingly strong, so that the land was filled with them. Now a new king arose over Egypt who did not know Joseph. He said to his people, "Look, the Israelite people are more numerous and more powerful than we. Come, let us deal shrewdly with them, or they will increase and, in the event of war, join our enemies and fight against us and escape from the land." Therefore, they set taskmasters over them to oppress them with forced labor. They built supply cities, Pithom and Ramses, for Pharaoh. But the more they were oppressed, the more they multiplied and spread, so that the Egyptians came to dread the Israelites. The Egyptians became ruthless in imposing tasks on the Israelites and made their lives bitter with hard service in mortar and brick and in every kind of field labor. They were ruthless in all the tasks that they imposed on them. The king of Egypt said to the Hebrew midwives, one of whom was named Shiphrah and the other Puah, "When you act as midwives to the Hebrew women and see them on the birth stool, if it is a boy, kill him, but if it is a girl, she shall live." But the midwives feared God. They did not do as the king of Egypt commanded them, but they let the boys live. So the king of Egypt summoned the midwives and said to them, "Why have you done this and allowed the boys to live?" The midwives said to Pharaoh, "Because the Hebrew women are not like the Egyptian women, for they are vigorous and give birth before the midwife comes to them." So God dealt with the midwives, and the people multiplied and became very strong. And because the midwives feared God, he gave them families. Then Pharaoh commanded all his people, "Every boy that is born to the Hebrews you shall throw into the Nile, but you shall let every girl live." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please join in singing our gospel hymn, "Thy Word."
Thank you.
Mary, you have to accept my invitation to unmute yourself.
Gotcha. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues, and proclaiming good news of the kingdom, and curing every disease and every sickness. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion for them, because they were harassed and helpless like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, ask the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest." Then Jesus summoned his 12 disciples and gave them authority over unclean spirits to cast them out and to cure every disease and every sickness. These are the names of the 12 apostles. First, Simon, also known as Peter, and his brother Andrew, James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John, Philip, and Bartholomew, Thomas and Matthew, the tax collector, James, son of Alphaeus, and Thaddeus, Simon the Canaanite, and Judas Iscariot, the one who betrayed him. These 12 Jesus sent out with the following instructions: "Go nowhere among the Gentiles and enter no town of the Samaritans, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. As you go, proclaim the good news. The kingdom of heaven has come near. Cure the sick, raise the dead, and cleanse the lepers. Cast out demons. You received without payment. Give without payment." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
May I speak in the name of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Deliver us. Thus begins the opening song in the 1998 film, The Prince of Egypt, which dramatizes the Exodus story for children. We are introduced to this central story in the history of our faith, the story our Jewish neighbors tell every year at Passover, the story we tell every year at the Easter Vigil, with a cry to God: deliver us. Deliver us out of bondage and deliver us to the promised land. This cry, this lament, this assertion that God is the one with the power to deliver, that God will do it, that God takes sides and has chosen to side with the oppressed, is the foundation of our faith. And yet, we rarely encounter this story in all its fullness in our worship. The vast majority of the passages we will hear this summer are cut out of our lectionary entirely, and the rest are a few small snippets taken out of context. We may have watched The Prince of Egypt as children or with our children. We may adore Charlton Heston's performance in The Ten Commandments. We may feel familiar with the outlines of Moses' story. But we fail to really grapple with the story of Exodus as a worshiping community. And so, this summer we will. We will hear this story in its entirety from today's depiction of how the Israelites came to be in bondage in the first place, to the pillar of fire that leads them through the Red Sea, beginning their journey to the Promised Land. We will contemplate what it means to worship a God who delivers. We will wonder how the bondage of the Israelites and God's rescue plan have been echoed in societies throughout history and across the globe, not least in our Lord Jesus Christ and his death on the cross. We will discover how we are called to follow this God in times of trouble, in times of bondage, in times of plague, in times of judgment, and a need to amend our ways that ultimately we may come to the kingdom of God, which is our promised land. Our story begins with, these are the names of the sons of Israel who came to Egypt with Jacob. We should probably give a little background on those names. The whole story of Genesis has chronicled God's relationship with a particular chosen family, the family of Abraham. God promised Abraham descendants and fulfilled that promise through Isaac, who had his own son, Jacob. God protected and guided Jacob through a challenging young adulthood, even though those challenges mostly were because of Jacob's own choices. And he gave him a new name, Israel. Israel slash Jacob had 4 wives and 12 sons and 70 other children, apparently. And his favorite of these sons was Joseph. Joseph's brothers resented the favoritism and sold him into slavery in Egypt. So you might think that's where our story begins today, but no. No, Joseph successfully escaped slavery and ended up as Pharaoh's deputy, the number 2 guy in all of Egypt. His brothers joined him there because they were fleeing a famine that engulfed not only the promised land in which they were living, but the whole Mediterranean, including Egypt, which was only surviving because of Joseph's shrewd leadership. Joseph forgave them, and the sons of Israel lived under his protection, and thus Pharaoh's, as strangers and aliens, foreigners in the land of Egypt. The Israelites, as they came to be known, were fruitful and prolific. They had many children and filled the land for generations after the death of Joseph and his brothers. Then a new king arose over Egypt who did not know Joseph. This king looked out at these people he chose not to claim as his own, though they were born in Egypt and had known no other home. He saw their numbers not as a testimony to the fruitfulness of the land and the blessing God had brought to his nation through them, but rather as a threat to the security and heritage of his people. The king ordered his people to oppress the Israelites with forced labor. Even under this brutal regime, however, God continued to bless the people with many children. So the Egyptians came to dread the Israelites, and in their terror, they became ruthless with them. Not content to only subject them to harsh labor in fields and building work, they compounded the harsh labor of childbirth by demanding that the midwives kill every baby boy born to the Israelites. Now, I want to take a minute with these midwives. It is not every woman in the Bible who gets to have her name remembered, but Shifra and Pua do. These women serve an oppressed population, a people that has been mislabeled as slaves. They are far from the center of power in their community. And it would be so easy for them to improve their position by zealously carrying out Pharaoh's demand. But they don't. They don't take the excuse that they're just following orders. They lie to Pharaoh. They trick him. They recognize that the God of the Israelites has more power than he does, and that Pharaoh's tyranny does not deserve the courtesy of an honest answer. Through these women, these low-status women, many baby boys are delivered in every sense of the word. God recognizes the worth of these women and blesses them, but Pharaoh is not content. He commands the people, not just his guards, but everyday average citizens too, to just randomly throw any baby boys that they encounter among the Israelites into the Nile. How amazing then that a baby boy carried by the Nile to Pharaoh's own palace will end up serving as God's agent of deliverance. But that's a story for next time. We haven't gotten to Moses yet. We are still trapped in bondage with the Israelites who've done nothing to harm their Egyptian neighbors. Pharaoh fears that in time of war they may side with his enemies, but they have not done so. They have been nothing but good neighbors. Their ancestor Joseph is the one who saved the Egyptians from the famine that brought them here in the first place. A little appreciation might seem to be in order. We might wonder at its absence. We might wonder at the behavior of the Egyptians. We might be horrified by it. We might stare aghast at their ruthlessness, their selfishness, their lack of compassion, even for women in childbirth. Except that we see echoes of this story throughout human history. When Jesus saw the crowds in our gospel passage today and had compassion on them because they were harassed and helpless, the word harassed doesn't mean overwhelmed or busy. It means oppressed. The word helpless doesn't mean weak. It means thrown to the ground by the might of empire. Like sheep without a shepherd doesn't mean they're in need of guidance because they're stupid. It means they're in need of protection from the wolves at their door. In Jesus's time, Exodus echoed. When African people were kidnapped and sold, when they were mislabeled as slaves and subjected to harsh labor more brutal than we want to remember, Exodus echoed. When foreigners find refuge in a new land, when they prosper in that new land in such a way that threatens those who view them as intruders rather than neighbors, Exodus echoed. When children are kidnapped and murdered, when their culture and language are forbidden them, when their very existence serves as a threat to those who wish they were safely relegated to the past, Exodus echoes. Throughout history, there have been pharaohs. And throughout history, God delivers. God delivers through Shifras and Puas throughout the generations who are not content to just follow orders. They are not content with the status quo. They fear God and know what is right. They take risks. They trick those in power in order to save God's children. God delivers. For God hears the cries of God's people and has compassion. God delivers when it appears that all is lost, that the fight is over, that even the children shall be shown no mercy. God delivers because a child escaped. That child fled with his family into Egypt, not away from it. That child knew what it was to be in danger. That child grew to have compassion upon the oppressed and preach good news to the poor. That child became the man, Jesus of Nazareth, who delivered us out of the power of even sin and death into the safe hands of God, who is always faithful. And so this summer, I invite you to pay attention. Pay attention to this story, this crucial story in our salvation history. pay attention to the echoes you see in the world around you. And pay attention for signs of God's deliverance. Because God has the power to deliver, God will do it. God takes sides and stands in the place as the shepherd for all who are harassed and helpless, oppressed and thrown to the ground. Amen. Our worship continues this morning as we affirm our faith using the words of the Hear, O Israel. Hear, O Israel.
The Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. This is the first and the great commandment. The second is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. There is no commandment greater than these.
Let us pray with confidence to the Lord, saying, Lord, hear our prayer.
Lord, hear our prayer.
O Lord, guard and direct your church in the way of unity, service, and praise.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Give to all nations an awareness of the unity of the human family.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Cleanse our hearts of prejudice and selfishness and inspire us to hunger and thirst for what is right.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Teach us to use your creation for your greater praise, that all may share the good things you provide.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Strengthen all who give their energy or skill for the healing of those who are sick in body or in mind.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Set free all who are bound by fear and despair.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Grant a peaceful end and eternal rest to all who are dying, and your comfort to those who mourn.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Teach us to use your creation. Almighty God, who created us in your image, grant us grace fearlessly to contend against evil and to make no peace with oppression, and that we may reverently use our freedom. Help us to employ it in the maintenance of justice in our communities and among the nations, to the glory of your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Almighty God, without you, we are not able to please you. Mercifully grant that your Holy Spirit may in all things direct and rule our hearts through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
All right. Are there any birthday or anniversary blessings this morning? You can type them into the chat or raise your hand. I'll make the window of you guys bigger so I can try and see hands. I know this is often a time of wedding anniversaries for many people, so if that's you, please raise your hand. Oh, looks like Candace is raising her hand, so I'll come back to that after the announcements. If there's anybody else, anybody who doesn't have your camera on this morning, then by all means, type it into the chat and we'll have a blessing after the announcements. I want to thank everybody who has been just a real source of support for the OPO family and for all of our community in this time. It is a real blessing to me to serve this community which is committed to the justice that God brings, and I am grateful for all of you. I did just want to make sure that people saw that our members of color are invited to a Zoom meeting on June 23rd at 5 p.m. This is intended to be a meeting for our Good Shepherd members of color to share stories and gather solidarity. There will be future meetings. We'll sort of figure out what we need to do next. What is something that the whole church community can do together? What kinds of conversations it might be valuable to invite our neighbors who live near the church. So this is not an isolated event. It is a beginning. And so I want everybody to know that we are thinking about next steps after that. We are just only announcing this one now. I also wanted to remind folks, if you hadn't noticed, the kids' check-in time has moved to 9:30 in the morning. Raylan had a wonderful time with the kiddos this morning. And so if you are missing out, then you're missing out. So I don't want you to miss out because you didn't see the time change in your weekly roundup. Let's see. Vestry is meeting tomorrow, and we hopefully will have some news coming from that meeting or possibly from future meetings regarding our reopening plans. As I've previously said, online worship is an option in every plan we are considering. So if you are a person feeling uncomfortable with the rising case counts here in Edmonton, rest assured that you are always going to be able, for the foreseeable future, you will be able to access our worship online. We're not quite sure how, we're not quite sure exactly what that's gonna look like, but we hear you and we care about your safety. That is our first and foremost goal, is to make sure that we are safe. All right, let's see. I am seeing Candace's hand raised, and I also saw in the chat that Rebecca and Anthony are celebrating 17 years of marriage today. I think that deserves a little golf clap. That's wonderful. Candace, what are you celebrating, seeking a blessing for?
Hello. Yeah. Good morning, everyone. Yes, our anniversary is on Tuesday, June the 16th.
Wonderful, wonderful. Well, let's say a blessing for our wedding anniversaries this week. That's wonderful. Congratulations. Let us pray. Oh God, our times are in your hand. Look with favor, we pray, on your servants as they begin another year. Grant that they may grow in wisdom and grace and teach them to trust in your goodness all the days of their lives through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you forever. Amen. Oh, Tina is saying that it's Elisa's birthday coming up. Blessings to Elisa as well. Absolutely. I'm so sorry. I missed that in the chat until just now. Thank you for sharing that with us, Tina. Happy to celebrate her birthday. And now, as we come into our time of offertory, I want to thank everyone who is generously donating to support our church's mission. Really, really grateful to all of you. Our work is far from done. Our work continues unabated. Our work is perhaps even more important than it ever has been before. And so thank you to everyone who makes that possible through your financial support. Whether you give in the hymn that follows or if you give throughout the week, know that the prayer over the gifts we will offer after this hymn is blessing your gifts to us, because you yourself are a blessing. And so now let us join in singing the offertory hymn, Great is Thy Faithfulness.
Thank you.
Reconciliation and forgiveness. The saving work of Christ has made our peace with you. May that work grow toward its perfection in all we offer you this day. We ask this in his name.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
May the God who shakes heaven and earth, whom death could not contain, who lives to disturb and heal us, bless you with power to go forth and proclaim the gospel. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you forever.
Amen.
Please join in singing our sending hymn, I Will Sing Unto the Lord.
Thank you.
let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.